to this class. In the last class we discussed this functional strategy. So, what is meant by functional strategy? When should organizations look at functional strategy? What are the three points with respect to functional strategy one should be looking at? That is the customer, the three tests rather, the customer value, that is the three tests for distinctive competency for the functional strategy to be effective or to be successful. So, one is the customer value, and then the customer, the competitor unique, the third is the extendability. So, customer value, as I mentioned, it must make a proportionate, it must make a disproportionate contribution to the customer's perceived value. What does it mean? Suppose he is expecting, by taking your product, he can expect an improvement on the existing product which he is using or on the competitor's product of about 5%. Suppose he gets more than 10%, let us say, then it is making a disproportionate contribution to his perceived value. He expected one or two attributes, that one or two attributes, instead of one or two attributes, he is actually getting more than the two attributes which he wanted. So, that is a great, that is a great contribution from your side, that is a company side for him. So, this could be one of the things. The second is, what is this competitor unique? This competitor unique is the product that you put out, the attributes or the characteristics, it must be unique and superior to competitor capabilities. So, not easily imitable. So, if the competitor tries to imitate also, it must take some time. That will give extendability to the life of the product. That is the third thing. So, this is where it must be something that can be used to develop new products or services or enter new markets also. So, you have developed upon something difficult for the competitor to copy, but at the same time you can use that technology concept that you have built in to come out with new products. New products or services that can help you to enter new markets. That is what was functional strategy. Now, compared to that, what is this outsourcing? So, this outsourcing refers to purchasing a product or service which the company was previously producing. So, when do you do this? This is a question which you have to answer. So, when does a company go in for outsourcing? Suppose it thinks that this is an area which can be handled better by other service providers. Let us say you are a manufacturing industry. You had your own transport establishment. That is what all the public sectors used to have in a city like Bangalore or in other cities of the country as well. So, you had a huge transport establishment. At one point of time, this public sector in unit like ITI or HCL had a large fleet of buses and a very big transport establishment to take care of those the maintenance of this fleet of buses, a large contingent of drivers, operations people, all those types of things. In other words, it was itself a company in that sense. Now, what is this outsourcing referring to? When you are doing such types of things, if you really see, you have to see whether, take the example which I gave of ITI. ITI is in the business of telecommunications. Now, whether the company can stick to the main line of telecommunications and outsource this transport activities to companies which are better equipped. Can be BMTC, which has a large number of buses, whether they can enter into agreements. So, this is an example which I am trying to quote. So, this is what many of the software industries have started doing or have already done. Take for example, Infosys has entered into an agreement with BMTC. Large number of buses of BMTC ply the employees of Infosys to the company and back. So, this is an outsourcing function. So, you have outsourced a function to a different service provider. Similarly, many of the other functions which the company thinks the service provider can be better equipped. For example, now many of the software companies have entrusted their payroll activities also to other service providers. They provide all this payroll act, they do all the payroll activities, every record is maintained outside the company, then brought into the company through the electronic media. So, this is the way it comes. So, similarly, the personal department's activity. So, many of the things outsourced, then the hospitality services outsourced. So, this is the type of thing. So, they now what do the companies say? The companies say this is our core competency. For example, Infosys or Wipro or TCS, they say our core competency is in providing software development services. So, we would like to concentrate on that, handle more number of projects. So, this is the way the companies are viewing. Now, earlier contrast this with the scenario which I just presented. ITI had at one point of time something like 164 buses almost crisscrossing the city of Bangalore. Everywhere you would see an ITI bus in every nook and corner of the city, had a huge establishment, large outgo. Now, all this, suppose the this is what is strategic planning. Suppose the company had done some strategic planning exercise right from the 80s, then all this could have been outsourced. So, which the company is now trying to do in a different way, having a small fleet of buses, things like that. But this is what outsourcing specifically refers to. The it is not the core competency of the firm, it is not where its distinctive competency lies. So, why not outsource that function or activity? So, the outsourcing refers to purchasing a product or service which the company was previously producing. So, something which was being done also can be outsourced to your what do you call many of these small scale industries that can also do some of the components and other things. So, earlier the parent company was doing, instead of that you have promoted an ancillary, that ancillary will suffer will supply this mother industry whenever it is required. So, a company like this HAL or ITI have large number of ancillary units also supplying products to the mother industry. So, then earlier the mother industry itself was producing that, now it is better for them to outsource this activity, and it is also good from the point of view of the ancillary, because the ancillary can also grow. So, what is this called in this is called the what do you if you really see the this is a supply chain activity. This in this supply chain activity, these are called the spin-offs which have resulted. So, you one industry, the mother industry has created so many spin-offs and so many indirect employment opportunities for so many people, and probably in the process resulting in so many new entrepreneurs coming up. A person who has set up his own ancillary to supply this mother unit, kindly note that he is also an entrepreneur. He is doing an entrepreneurial activity and he is supplying this mother industry, say ITI or HAL. So, this is the way it is going. Now, this is outsourcing. So, the key to outsourcing lies in purchasing from outside only those activities that are not key to company's distinctive competencies. This is what I explained to you.
Hello, sir.
Yes. This is the way the so if the company it is not in its core competence area, then it can give it to outside sources. So that is better for the company to do. Now the next thing, we looked at outsourcing. Now let us look at marketing. What is this marketing strategy? This marketing strategy deals with the pricing, selling and distribution of a product, very vital to the company. So, company produces the product, now how do you market this product? The most important thing is the pricing strategy. How do you price this product? So, around this, so much of research goes on. At what level this product should be priced, and if we price it a little higher, how is it going to affect the demand? A little lower, by how much the demand will increase? All those types of things. A big market research team will always be looking at all these options. So, of course, being helped by the strategic management team overseeing all this activity. Now, how does this activity help this company? Let us say that is marketing strategy. Using this strategy, the business unit can improve its market share for current products through market saturation and penetration, or develop new products for existing markets. So, you decide using this strategy whether you want to continue with the same products or whether you want to continue with some new products for the existing markets or new products for the new markets. That is whether you want to go in for diversification, what is the type of diversification you want to do, all these types of things can be thought of. Then the next one which the company should think is what is called the financial strategy. What does a financial strategy look at? The financial strategy examines the financial implications at corporate and business levels to identify the best financial course of action. So, these experts in finance, that is a finance team, they do a pretty thorough analysis of any investment decision. So, a finance man looks at every strategic decision from the finance angle. He is not worried about the policy angle, he is looking at the finance angle. How much does the what is the company's outgo due to this decision? Then, how much is it coming inflow? The outgo and the inflow, the two things which he is heavily concerned with. Now, suppose the inflow to the company, that is a cash inflow to the company, is more than the outgo. He normally expects that it will be like that. By how much is it? That is, what is the times by which this inflow is more than the outgo? He is more concerned about that. Say, is it 10% more than the outgo or 20% more than the outgo, then he will have some yardstick. Okay, if it is 20% more than the outgo, the inflow, then I will put a tick for this strategy. That is, this strategy can be looked at. If it is not more than 20%, I would prefer to be cautious, not go with this strategy. So, he expects the returns to be at that level. So, why does he expect in that manner? He is not looking at the competitor per se, but he is looking at, suppose the, as a strategic planner, you come back to the finance department and say, give me more money, because this investment is required to keep this product in the market, otherwise we will lose our competitive advantage, the company loses its competitive advantage. Then he must be having some inflow cushion, that is the inflow into his company, the company, he must be having that to provide you that investment. So, that is the one which gives you this competitive advantage, that is the one which helps you to lower your cost of the product if it is required at some point of time. So, the financial man is concerned at that. So, he is concerned with whether it can provide competitive advantage through lower cost of funds and flexibility to raise capital. What do you mean by flexibility to raise capital? Suppose he goes to the bank, that is a company goes to the bank and says, we are producing this product and we have this market share, that is we are able to market this many number of units of this product and we get a sales revenue of like this. You would like to borrow some money from the bank or the financial institution. Normally the financial institution will look at what is the operations which this firm is doing. And once he is convinced, he is prepared to lend based on the performance of the product in the market. So, the market performance holds the key, and once the market performance is good, it can bring you additional investment, not just from the company side, even if the company does not have, the company can mobilize that resource from financial institutions, be it banks or other resources. So, this strategy normally what does it do? It helps in maximizing the financial value. So, you put 1 rupee, can that 1 rupee get you 2 rupees? That is 100%. So, many times it is being said that this maximizing the financial value in the Indian conditions, where is it happening? So, many say, what is the usual answer which is given? Many say it happens in the liquor industry. What do you mean by saying it happens in the liquor industry? They say you put your 1 rupee there, it brings you 4 rupees. That is for the company investor, you put the 1 rupee, it brings you 400 rupees, it brings you 4 rupees. What does that mean? It means it is a 400% margin. So, when you are getting that type of margin, 300 to 400% margin, what does that mean? So, you put 1 rupee, you got 4 rupees, that is 3 rupees extra. That can be used to make investment in other units which are not giving you that much of advantage, financial advantage. So, that will bolster their financial confidence also, and they can perform better in the marketplace. This is the financial strategy. Now, the next one which we want to look at is what is called the R&D strategy. All this is, these are all some things new, kindly note this. A company was, if you look at the 80s or even the up to the mid 80s also, sometimes the late 80s also. These companies were not looking at strategies in this compartment wise. So, they were looking at corporate plans, they were looking at what do you call the company as a whole, but now the scenario, this global scenario, globalization or the liberalization, what has it done? It has made the company to look at each and every functional area with a microscope. So, each and every functional area they are trying to drop a strategy. So, R&D, earlier the company never used to bother about R&D so much. Now, R&D has become an important component because the industry looks at R&D for improving the product. Earlier R&D was considered, okay, it is also a department in the company. Never were they used to checking what is the R&D doing. Is it doing something useful to the company, how it is useful, all those checks were not being applied, but now it is being applied regularly. Suppose you say you want to do this development in R&D, they will ask, that is the funding will ask, that is the finance will before doing that they will ask how it is useful to the company. So, some justification required for you to draw the money from the company side. So, the R&D strategy determines the R&D mix that a company has to follow. So, this is where this whole R&D in the present day circumstances is being influenced by this concept of QFD, that is called quality function deployment. So, you get the feedback from the customer. How do you get the feedback from the customer? The feedback from the customer, you get it through the marketing department. The marketing department may not be able to fully analyze that feedback, but gives it to R&D, gives it to the production department. So, what is the job of the R&D? The job of the R&D is to sift through that feedback about the product received from the market and take that feedback, which can be used to put as a new attribute for the product. So, this some of these examples which I have given already and which companies have implemented. A very good example is that of this two-wheeler industry. So, TVS company trying to get the feedback from the market. So, the initial feedbacks which they were getting when they were using the kickstart was by the time the vehicle could be started, the signal would have changed back to red. Then came the pedal start, then the pedal start, then the kickstart, then came this electronic start. So, now you have the electronic start and the kickstart both together in most of the vehicles which are coming, so that you are having the flexibility between a kickstart and the electronic start. They normally, the company people advise you, when you are starting the vehicle first time in the morning, you do the kickstart, then you can regularly use the electronic start throughout the day, nothing will happen. So, this is the way, how has it come about? This is the QFD, that is the feedback from the customer translated into an attribute of the product, and that attribute successful in the market. So, whatever is successful in the marketplace, how does it get reflected? It will get reflected in your competitor also copying the same or imitating the same. So, many of the new vehicles that have come have got this characteristic. So, they have the kickstart also, they have this electronic start also. So, this is what, as I told you, the strategy lends itself. So, suppose to the extent that it is hard for the competitor to imitate your product, there is an extendability concept which comes in, and to that extent your advantage will be a sustainable competitive advantage in the marketplace. So, the R&D strategy determines the R&D mix that a company has to follow. Then it determines the mix of basic research, product development and process R&D. Normally, what is the thinking? The thinking is the basic research is to be done by the educational institutions. The applied R&D to be done by the industries concerned. Similarly, the process R&D. Now, how is the thinking changing? This is a very wonderful idea. Now, the company is also saying, we also do some basic research. That is, let us set apart some funds for basic research. Let us not depend only on the universities or the educational system to do the basic research. Let us do some basic research ourselves. If we are not able to do in the company concerned, let us see whether we can tie up with the university system or some other educational institution and see whether they can do, they can have a dedicated lab for our basic research activity. So, this is a type of thinking which has come about, radical changes in R&D thinking. This is the strategic changes which have come about after this globalization process was initiated, or we came into this process after 91. This strategy also influences the decisions in the areas of development of new technologies, acquisition of technology from external sources, strategic alliances, then product stroke process innovation and improvement. See, earlier, if you really look at the 90s, whatever product you got from abroad, it used to have a market value added in the Indian market. What do you mean by that? That is an imputed market value. You brought this product, let us say, from your neighboring country like Singapore, and it said, this is a product which I brought from Singapore. Suppose you brought it at X rupees, it will get many times the market value, imputed market value, it will get jacked up, it will be X plus 0.5X, 50% jack up will be there. Oh, it is a Singapore product. Suppose you brought it from a country like the United States, again a market, imputed market value. Now, those things have changed. What do you see in 2010? Suppose you see, you say that this product is from abroad. The Indian customer is not greatly enthused, or he won't give a great hype to that product. In other words, what does it mean? He is prepared to do a rational analysis of this product, which you say or which you claim you have brought from abroad. He will try to find out whether there is an existing Indian product and then make a comparison, take a decision whether he should go in for this product or the existing product in the Indian market. So, he will do comparisons with respect to attributes, the characteristics of the product, the performance of the product, then also the price, and then the type of warranties which go with the, this thing. So, this is a classic example, because if you really see, so take the two-wheeler industry. Earlier, TVS used to had a tie-up with Suzuki. Now, TVS vehicles is coming under the brand name of TVS only, not TVS Suzuki. Now, what is the market, how has the market reacted? There is a vehicle of TVS also, there is a vehicle of Suzuki also, but the market share of TVS not dented, because the Indian consumer is able to make an assessment and say, yes, I will stick with TVS only, no need to go for Suzuki. So, even the original brand of Suzuki, who was giving an added value to a local manufacturer or the Indian manufacturer, finds it tough when he himself makes an entry into the marketplace in India due to this liberalized scenario to dislodge this TVS from the market leader's place or with respect to some of the segments, product segments. He finds it, oh, So, the original brand of TV Suzuki itself not able to dislodge. Same things with respect to many of the other products also. So, I used to mention to you the way this Indica car has taken the four-wheeler market. Controlling nearly 17% market share, which is very high. So, almost every cab going as a Tata Indica one. Okay. So, this is the way the Indian market is now acting towards. So, this is how has this been possible? All this is possible because of the different strategies which are being looked at through what do you call a lens now in the present day scenario. The next one which the company looks at with respect to the strategy is what is the operation strategy. That is, where do you produce this? That is, where do you produce a product? What is the type of vertical integration that you would like to have? What is the type of deployment of resources? What is that supplier chain relationship management you would like to have? What is the technology to be used? And what is the levels of quality to be achieved? So, here you are seeing, what is that you are seeing? You are seeing there are so many strategies, and all these strategies, though they look like compartments, are closely linked, they are intertwined. They are not, what do you call, mutually exclusive compartments. So, they would like to see that these strategies are implemented so that the objectives of the company can be achieved better. The other one which the company normally uses is what is called this purchasing strategy. In fact, before we go to this purchasing strategy, I would like to read out the type of operation strategy which is adopted by this Whirlpool company. So, I am reading from my own book, this Whirlpool. I am looking at the Whirlpool of India. Whirlpool of India Limited, a part of the US home appliance major Whirlpool Corporation, is a leading player in the white goods market, commanding a 27% market share in refrigerators and 20% in washing machines. Already a leading player in washing machines, the company now plans to enter the lower segment of the market to cater to the middle income group. Now, Whirlpool's success formula is simple. It continuously innovates its products, keeping in mind customer preference and market demands. As a result, Whirlpool products have some of the most user-friendly features. For instance, its microwave's unique tawa can cook Indian dishes like parathas, crisp dosas, and kebabs. The sixth sense feature knows whether the food is cooked or needs to be cooked further. The three-dimensional wave distribution system ensures that there are no hot and cold areas in the dishes, and food is cooked thoroughly even when the turntable is switched off. The white magic range of semi-automatic washing machines have hand wash agitators, and its unique rotating brush with soft flexible bristles removes tough strains, especially from collars and cuffs, without damaging them. The ice magic refrigerator makes ice about 20 minutes faster than any other refrigerator in the same category. Having enriched its product range with such uniquely featured high-tech appliances, Whirlpool is confident that it can enhance customer loyalty for the brand and consolidate its leadership position in the industry. So, this is how the operation strategy of Whirlpool is was really looked. It was a look at the operation strategy in the early 2001-2002, how Whirlpool was really capturing the Indian market. Now, look at this purchasing strategy. What do you do in purchasing strategy? Decisions regarding raw materials, parts and suppliers for the manufacturing function are influenced by the purchasing strategy. The company has the options of single, multiple or parallel sourcing. So, what do you mean by this? You are looking at one portion of the supply chain, very important portion of the supply chain, that is the raw materials, parts and suppliers for the manufacturing function. And you start looking whether you should have a single source supply or a parallel source supply or a multiple source supply. What is a single source? How does it help? It helps in reduction of both cost and time and in controlling quality, because you are looking at the quality of one source only. What about this parallel sourcing? It provides two suppliers for two different parts, with each of them backing up the other's parts. So, there is a tie, there is a tie-in type of thing which gets involved. So, one person may be producing one component, can be an outer component, the other person may be producing an inner component, the outer component and the inner component have to mesh together. So, properly for the complete part to come out correctly. Then what is this multiple sourcing? It has an advantage in that it forces suppliers to compete, leading to reduction in costs and improvement in quality for the company. So, what are you trying to do? You are giving a signal to the suppliers that unless and until he is competitive, he cannot be a regular supplier to the company. He must be prepared to supply at competitive rates. That will only enable the company to bring out its end products at and price it competitively in the competitive market scenario that you are facing. So, this is the type of thing which the company might be the signal that you are sending to the suppliers of products. You are saying to the different suppliers, come on, be competitive. You cannot be quoting more to the company, because the end product's price will be influenced by all this. So, what does as a purchasing man, you can do your own analysis and come to that alternative which is best in the interest of the company, whether it is single sourcing or parallel sourcing or multiple sourcing. Then the other thing which the company is concerned now, this is this area is becoming more predominant in the present day context. This is what is called the logistics strategy. What is this logistics strategy? It deals with the flow of the product into and out of the manufacturing function. So, you are concerned with the transportation here. So, how the products are getting transported out of the company and the raw materials or whatever into the company. This requires synergies across business units and expertise in transportation modes. So, you may like to optimize by the different modes, transportation modes. You may say some part I will get it by air, some part I will get it by road, some part I will get it by rail or ship. So, if it is advisable, I may mix these modes. This is how the logistics man should be thinking. Sometimes in some of the companies, this logistics, an effective logistics strategy can help boost your profits, that is a company's profits, nearly 5 to 10%, and that is a huge boost, kindly note that. So, by effectively doing this logistics strategy, you can contribute to the company's profits, that is the enhancement of profits. Two important decisions on logistics strategy, whether it should be centralized or whether it should be outsourced. Centralized means where the company looks at it from the company's this thing only, premises only. Outsourced means you give it to a service provider, he takes care of the logistics, enter into an agreement. Why do you outsource this? You think that this is not my distinctive competence area, let me outsource it and be comfortable with my area of business. So, this is also being done by many of the manufacturing units as well. So, this many of these well known logistics companies, so whether it is your FedEx or if it is a courier, different companies operating, all these even postal services, which the courier company is acting as a parallel to the postal services. You courier it through different couriers, whether it is a professional courier or the Blue Dart, all these types of courier business companies. Now, all this is something which you can take a decision whether you should centralize or whether you should outsource. Similarly, the other strategies which the company is concerned with is the human resource management strategy, that is deals with the recruitment of skilled employees and their training to participate in self-managed work teams. So, even this function, hiring at the lower levels, it is outsourced. Many recruiting firms do this hiring, so data operators, key in board operators, all these types of, or your what do you call, call center operators, all these who are required to be hired in mass numbers, sometimes even personal managers. So, this is given, this is outsourced. And the firm, this recruitment firm does this job, ultimately zeroes in on the person concerned and gives it to the company and takes a price for the services provided. And many times they also provide them training. But in the case of software services, when you are being recruited, let us say as an engineer, the company would like to get actively involved in the selection process. It would not like to give it to this outsourcing firm only. Even when it is given to the outsourcing firm, the company's representatives will be there in good numbers to see that the company's objectives are achieved. And when the company recruits these people, they are sent to training programs which are of particular interest to the individual's work area. So, the company ensures that he is molded well before taking up the job in the self, in this training programs or training processes which the company wants him to participate. So, many of them have built wonderful training centers, and in fact many of these training centers which are built by these software majors in the Indian context, their services are being used by other global companies as well. You find that many global companies use the facilities which are provided by these Indian companies. Then what is this information system strategy? Information systems makes use of information technology to provide companies with competitive advantage. You can be a manufacturing firm, but you cannot stay away from IT now. You just do not say that, oh, IT is not the business I am in. You may not be in the business of IT, but you can use, or you have to use IT as a facilitator for your business. This is a scenario which has presented itself now. So, a small travel agent to a big manufacturing industry, not the IT industry, big manufacturing industry. All of both these people make use of the IT, the information technology, to stay in business, to further business. This is the type of scenario which you are in, because if you do not make use of it, then your competitor will make use of that and you lose your competitive advantage in the marketplace. So, these are the different types of strategies which you can see. And now, when you have so many strategies, you have a functional strategy, you have this outsourcing, you have this marketing strategy, you have the financial strategy, you have the R&D strategy, and you have this operation strategy, purchasing strategy, logistics strategy, HR strategy, information system strategy. So, what does this provide you? It provides you with a strategic choice. It provides you with a lot of choice. Which strategy I will pick up? Whether I will go in for this X strategy or Y strategy, and how will I pick up this X or Y? So, this is what is called the strategic choice and the development of policies. So, you start evaluating the alternative strategies. The strategic choice represents the evaluation of alternative strategies and selection of the best alternative. It is a huge gamut. Large number of alternatives are presented. Which one will you pick up? You have to be extremely judicious in picking up the best alternative. So, a lot of analysis goes through the whole process before you say you tick this particular course of action and say, for this I am going in the operation strategy mode, for this I am going in the financial strategy mode, for this I am going in the marketing strategy mode. So, the company has to do its homework very thoroughly in the present day marketing environment. It cannot afford to lag behind. So, this is the way the company looks at its whole strategic process in the present competitive market scenario. So, now look at what all we have done. We started looking at the firm, its environment, that is the internal environment of the firm, the external environment of the firm, what is the relevant environment of the firm. Then we started saying, using all this environment, we do what is called a business scape analysis, and this business scape analysis was used to come out with one matrix. that is the EFAS matrix. Now, what is the this thing? So, the company, we started saying, let us look at our strengths and weaknesses, all those types of internal analysis. We developed what is called an IFAS matrix. Using the EFAS and the IFAS matrix, we developed what is called the SFAS matrix, that is the strategic factor analysis matrix. And we said this is the type of strategic alternatives which can be used by the company. That is, the SFAS matrix helps you to decide on the best strategic factors. Then what did we do? We said we considered all the types of different strategies here using the portfolios. We looked at the portfolio analysis and then we looked at all the different types of strategies. So, we have looked at different types of portfolios. We looked at this what should be your net cash flow, that is the inflow versus the outflow, all those types of things to look at the different types of strategies. That is what. Then why did we look at all this? We wanted to have a better decision making ability with respect to the best alternative strategy. So, you have a large number of alternatives that will provide you with which is the best choice to go. And how does that help? It helps in better policy decisions for the company. So, the company is in a better position to take informed policy decisions. So, earlier it was not having, in the earlier scenario prior to the 90s, it was not having this type of information backup to take a strategic decision. Now, in this scenario of 2010, the company has got a lot of information backup before it says this is a strategic decision alternative which I am considering. So, we stop here. Before we go further, I will be giving you 3 assignments on the topics which we have done so far, which you can consider answering, gives you a better idea of what all we have covered. Thank you.